morning dear students, welcome back to our lesson, the fundamental unit of life. In my previous session, I had explained you about cell membrane, how the important cell membrane is into the cell. On all the terms related to the cell membrane, I have explained you in the previous session. Now, today we are looking forward for the cell wall, okay, which is also the important component of the plant cell and the fungal cell and some prokaryotes also. So our today's topic is cell wall, the important component of the plant cell. If you see the structure of the cell wall, it would be like this little. Okay, inside it, the cell is present and this structure is called as what? Cell wall. And do you know, student, who is first discovered it, cell wall? I think if you have watched my first session of this lesson, that is fundamental unit of life, then you can give the answer of my question that cell wall is first discovered by the Robert Hooke. I said you, Robert Hooke has taken one cork cell which he has obtained from the bark of the tree, and when he observed in his own primitive microscope which he had made, he could found one structure under the microscope that was hexagonal, which was resembling to the honeycomb, right? And that structure is nothing but our cell wall. So he is the only scientist, first scientist to discover the cell wall. So this all credit goes to the Robert Hooke. So Robert Hooke has discovered the cell wall. Okay, if you will see the structure of the cell wall, then some points are there which you can mention along with me, okay, in your notebook. The first point of the structure is, it is the outermost covering of the plant cell, some fungal cell and some prokaryotes also. It's the outermost covering, of plant cell, fungal cell and some prokaryotes, I think term is clear for you. I said you in biology, whenever pre or pro will come, which will be resembling to the, this word is saying about the some lower organisms, okay, not completely advanced organisms, some lower organisms. This is the term is utilized in the biology. So this is the outermost covering of the plant cell. In the plant cell, cell membrane is not the outermost covering. Cell membrane is the outermost covering for the animal cell. But for plant cell, the outermost covering, which is designed like this, it is for the plant cell, fungal cell and some prokaryotes. It is there. Okay. So this is the first important structure in the, it's the first important point about the structure of the cell wall. Now, how this cell wall is made up of? It is made up of cellulose, students. It is made up of cellulose. It is made up of cellulose. Okay. Then third point, if we will talk about it, then it is semi-transparent. It is rigid. And it's a semi-transparent, it is rigid and it is dead, it's not living, it is non-living, or we can say it is dead, okay. And if we will talk about the further point about the cell wall is, which is the difference between the cell membrane and the cell wall, it's a freely permeable membrane, okay, okay students. So you can mention this point about the structure of the cell wall in your notebook, okay, or you may take a screenshot, no problem about it. So it is the outermost covering of a plant cell, fungal cell or some prokaryotes. It is made up of cellulose, means this layer is made up of cellulose. It's a semi-transparent, it is rigid and it is not living, it's a dead, right? And it is freely permeable. Okay, what is mean by freely permeable? We will see into the function of the cell wall. So this is all about the structure. Now we will look after or we will look forward for the function of the cell wall. As it is rigid, what might be the function of the cell wall, students? Can you guess? As it is rigid and it is the outermost covering or outermost layer of the plant cell, then it is protective. It provides what? It provides shape, size, right? Mechanical support, protection. And stiffness to the plant. What it does, as it is rigid, right? It provides, and it is dead, right? So it provides a shape, right? Then it is provide a size, support, mechanical support. It provides protection and stiffness to the plant cell. Okay, because plants are not moving, right? They don't have any locomotory organ, right? Like us. So whenever we want to protect ourselves, we can enter in our house or we can protect ourselves as we have a locomotory organ. But plants do not have. And because of that, they have a, by the nature, they have for their stiffness, for their mechanical support, protection, they are having this outermost layer that is called as a cell wall. And I said you, that is, it is freely permeable. What does it mean? It's a freely permeable. Freely permeable means it can allow for the entry and exit of some substances and compounds in it without any hindrance or without any interference. It can allow any substances and compound inside it. Okay, like cell membrane, we have seen that it is a selectively permeable membrane. Okay, we have seen that cell membrane is a selectively permeable membrane. But cell wall is not a selectively permeable membrane. It can allow any substance and any compound into the cell. At the same time, it can allow to go outside any compound and substance from the cell. Okay, so I may suggest that it is working like our gate. Our gate we have for our home or house or bungalow, we have one main gate. From that main gate, anybody can enter inside. So we can resemble that gate with our cell wall. Means from cell wall, anybody can enter. But from the cell membrane, if we wish, then only it can come inside. Right? So cell wall, it allow any compound, in and out to the cell wall without any interference or without any hindrance. Right, students? So this is the second most important property of the cell wall. Okay, and if you will see, this is actually providing a great shape to the cell, right? Now student, we will move ahead for the term that is plasmolysis, which is related to the cell wall. Okay, and for to show the experiment of the plasmolysis, we need one hypotonic solution. Okay, through one experiment, and during these days as you are at home, you can also do this experiment at home. It's very easy. For that experiment, you will only need a hypertonic solution, student. And in my previous session, I explained you hypertonic solution means what? Hypertonic solution is also called as a concentrated solution. Hypertonic solution means the amount of solute particle will be more into the solution. Actually, the solution is made up of two important components. That is solute and solvent. Okay. And solute, if it will be in the more quantity, then that solution will be more concentrated, or such solution is called as a hypertonic solution. it will contain more amount of solute. It will contain more amount of solute. Okay. So for this experiment, to show you plasmolysis experiment, I will be in need of one beaker, and in that beaker I will need hypertonic solution. Hypertonic solution is also called as a concentrated solution. Okay, means it will contain the more amount of salt in it. And if I will put any plant cell in it, then what will happen? Inside the plant cell, the amount of water is more than outside. Understood, student? Inside the water, inside the cell, the amount of water is more, and outside the amount of water is less as compared to the cell I am talking about. Because of that, what will happen? We have seen the term osmosis. In the osmosis, what happened? The movement of water is taking place from higher concentration to the lower concentration. Now, if we have a closer look towards it, then you will be able to find that inside the amount of water is more, outside the amount of water is less. So, because of exosmosis, exosmosis means what will happen? The water will come outside. Okay, the direction of the water will be like this. The water will try to come outside, right? So the movement of water from the cell to the outside surrounding is called as a exosmosis. And the result of the exosmosis is what? This cell will be shrunken. Shrunken cell, or flaccid also we can say the term. Flaccid. The cell will get shrink. Shrunken cell we will found. The cell will get shrink along with cell membrane and cytoplasm. Both will get shrink. Because water has loosed from the cell by the process of what? Exosmosis. And this process all together is called what? Plasmolysis. Okay, student? So this is all about plasmolysis. If one interesting thing about this deep plasmolysis is, if we will take out, now the cell is shrunken, okay? Now the cell is shrunken, we can see. The cell is shrunken. Now, if the shrunken cell we will keep into the hypotonic solution. What is mean by hypotonic solution? Means now the amount of solute particles are less in it. It's a diluted solution. So we will same cell, if you will try to put into the hypotonic solution, then what will happen? Inside, the water concentration is less, while outside the water concentration is more. So what will happen? The water will enter inside. From outside to inside. And which process will take place? Endoosmosis. Endoosmosis process will take place, and the cell will become again at the normal size. Okay, or it will be again swollen. And this process is called as what? Deplasmolysis. It is called as a deplasmolysis. Okay, student. So this is all about our cell wall, means structure of the cell wall, then the function of the cell wall, and the plasmolysis term. Okay, now we will move ahead for the another component of the cell, that is called as what? That is called as cytoplasm. Okay, that is called as a cytoplasm. This is what? Cytoplasm. If we will see to the cytoplasm, this cytoplasm, it contains what exactly? What it contains? It contains cell organelles and nucleus in it. It contains cell organelles and nucleus in it. And how is the structure of it? This we are talking about structure only. How is the exact structure of this cytoplasm? It's a fluidy. It is gelatinous. It is gelatinous, colorless matrix. Colorless matrix. Okay, it is colorless. It does not have any color. It's a gelatinous fluid. Means water component are more in it. And this all material are cell organelle and nucleus are suspended. Understood? And how this material is made up of what? This, it is made up of it. This substance or cytoplasm, it is made up of water and some organic and inorganic compound Okay student, do you get it? All cell organelles such as your Golgi apparatus, your nucleus is also important cell organelle, okay, which is the largest cell organelle into the cytoplasm, ribosome, endoplasmic reticulum, every cell organelle we are going to see in detail, okay. But all the cell organelles and nucleus is suspended into the cytoplasm. And what is the exactly cytoplasm? Cytoplasm is a fluidy, gelatinous, watery or colorless substance, okay, which is watery especially. And it is made up of what? Water is the main fundamental unit of the cytoplasm. Water is present, as well as organic and some inorganic compounds are also present into the cytoplasm. Okay, so this is all about the structure of the cytoplasm. Now, what is the function of the cytoplasm? What might be the function of the cytoplasm, student? Can you guess what is the function? As all the cell organelles are present in it, means cell organelles are going to perform their specific function, right? We are going to say, I don't want to disclose now what the cell organelles are doing because it is also going to be very interesting in future. So cell organelles are performing their own role over here. Specific cell organ is performing specific role. Okay. Then all metabolic processes are also going on into the cell cytoplasm. Metabolic process, the important metabolic process, because of it we are survived, that is respiration. Okay. So that respiration is one of the important metabolic process. That metabolic process, as well as excretion, everything is going on into the cytoplasm. So metabolic processes are going on into the cytoplasm. Metabolic processes are going on into the cytoplasm. And student, very important cell organelle is present into the cytoplasm, and the name of that cell organelle is called as a mitochondria. See, sadharan, if it is a nucleus, then you will see, and various mitochondria are present. Like this structure is present. This is the structure of what? Mitochondria. Okay? Mitochondria are present. And mitochondria is called as a powerhouse of the cell or energy currency of the cell. Means whatever food we eat, right? We eat carbohydrates, proteins and lipids. This is our basic food. Okay, or this food is actually the main component of our food. These are the important nutrients in our diet. So, this carbohydrates, this proteins and this lipids, especially I will talk about the carbohydrates. The carbohydrates converts into glucose. Okay, when this carbohydrates are converts into the glucose, then they goes into this cytoplasm. And the breaking down of the glucose is taking place into the pyruvic acid. Means from one glucose molecule, two pyruvate or two pyruvic acids are made. right? So breaking down of glucose is called as what? Glycolysis process, which you will learn in your class 10. So that glycolysis process leads to two pyruvate molecule, and when this pyruvate molecule come in contact with the oxygen which is present into the cell, then that process is called as a aerobic respiration. And aerobic respiration will give a ATP molecule, okay, 38 ATP molecule we will get by this process. And ATP is what? Adenosine triphosphate. Adenosine triphosphate is one of the energy currency of our body, energy currency of the cell or powerhouse of the cell. So whenever we need energy for physical work maybe, or for metabolic processes, means for circulation, for nutrition, for digestion process, as well as for reproduction process, for various process, even for thinking process, we need some amount of energy, and that energy is taken by this ATP. So this very important phenomenon is going on into the cytoplasm, into one of the important cell organelle that is called as a mitochondria. So whenever the topic of the mitochondria would come, I shall explain you in detail the function of the mitochondria. Here I would like to know you this important function is performed by the mitochondria and which is suspended into the cytoplasm. So this is all about the cytoplasm. Okay, now we will move ahead for one important cell organelle. That is called as what, student? Nucleus. That is called what? Nucleus. Okay? Nucleus. Nucleus is performing it is actually the VIP structure of the cell. Why it is called the VIP? That also I shall explain you. Okay? So, if you see the structure of this nucleus, you will get to see like the structure. If you will try to observe it under the microscope, we will get to see the structure like this. Actually, student, it is the double membrane. It's a double membrane. And it is bounded by the endoplasmic reticulum also. It is bounded by endoplasmic reticulum also. It may be rough or it may be smooth. Everywhere around this nucleus, this cell is found. In the nucleus, this structure is present. That is called as nucleolus. This structure is called as what? Nucleolus. And one thread-like structure is all around, you can see. This thread-like structure is called what? Chromatin. This is called as what? Chromatin fiber or chromatin material. Chromatin fiber or chromatin material, which is found, means if we will take any bowl and we will keep a Maggi. You like, students, to eat Maggi, right? So how it would look in a bowl Maggi? Like that it is looking. This chromatin fiber looks into the nucleus like a Maggi into the bowl. Okay, you can now imagine how it might be looking. And that Maggi is also thread-like. So this is also thread-like structure. And this is called as a chromatin fiber. Okay, this is called as a chromatin material or chromatin fiber. Beside it, you can see this structure. This is called as a nuclear envelope. This is called as what? Nuclear envelope. Okay. And this structure means between the two nuclear envelope, this structure you can found. This is called as what? Nuclear pore. This structure is called as what? Nuclear pore. And if you will see this structure, this nuclear membrane is always a double layer. This is double layer nuclear membrane. This is double layer nuclear membrane. Okay. And inside whatever material is there, means that nucleolus and chromatin fiber, this all together is called as what? Nucleoplasm. This is called as what? Nucleoplasm. Nucleoplasm. okay, as we have seen cytoplasm. Likewise, nuclear membrane is also there, which has a small pore in it. Why this pore are designed? This pore are designed to enter the protein, and some important material for exit and for regulating the entry and exit of this protein and the DNA material. That process we will learn in detail. This nuclear pore is designed. Do you understand? Some important hereditary material which get transferred from one generation to the next generation or during our simple cell division also. For that sake we needed it. So for that sake, entry and exit, this nuclear pore is designed, okay? And this is nucleoplasm in which this chromatin fiber is present, and this nucleolar structure is also found in it. So this is the structure of what? Nucleus. Okay, normally, and this is what? This structure you can see, this is called as the endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, if this endoplasmic reticulum would have a small dots, these dots are called as what? Ribosome. These dots are called what? Ribosome. Okay, ribosomes are synthesizing proteins. Okay, ribosomes are synthesizing proteins. If these ribosomes are present on the endoplasmic reticulum, then that is called as a rough endoplasmic reticulum. Why it is termed as a rough endoplasmic reticulum? Because ribosomes are like a crystal-like material is present. Means if we will try to touch it, we are unable to touch it, but it is really a crystalline in appearance, and so that such kind of reticulum is called as a rough endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, and if these ribosomes are absent on the endoplasmic reticulum, then such endoplasmic reticulum is called as a smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, and ribosomes are also present into the cytoplasm, that we will see. Okay, so this is all about the structure of the nucleus. One more time I would like to explain you. This is nuclear envelope. This middle portion is called as a nuclear pore. Inside it the thread-like material is called, that is called as a chromatin fiber. And this is nucleolus. This structure is called as a endoplasmic reticulum. And this structure is double layer actually. All together it is called as a nucleoplasm. Endoplasmic reticulum will have a small dot-like structure, will called as a ribosome. Altogether, it is called as a rough endoplasmic reticulum. If dot-like structure is not present, then it is called as a smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So, this is all about the structure. Now, student, one interesting thing is that this chromatin fiber is arranged into the haphazard manner. Anyhow, it is arranged, right? But it is acquiring a specific shape at a certain period. When does it acquire a shape? When there is a time of a cell division. Actually, student, we have two types of cells in our body. Somatic cells and the genetic cell. Genetic cells are present only in our sex cells. Into the female, these genetic cell or the sex cells are present into the ovum or egg cell. And the sperm cells are present into the sperm cell is the sex cell of the male. It's a male sex cell. So in this both cell, the gametic cell or the sex cell, the chromosomes are present. Okay, but those chromosomes are haploid type of chromosome that I shall let you know later. And other somatic cells are called as a diploid cell. Okay, so we have a 23 pairs of chromosomes. In every cell we have a 23 pairs of chromosomes. Okay, but our sex cells will have a half number of chromosomes, means half number. Only 23 chromosomes we will have in a sex cell. Right, into the female sex cell and into the male sex cell, as ovum cell and the sperm cell will have a 23 chromosomes, while in other cells, somatic cells will have a 23 pairs of chromosomes, means 46 chromosomes we will have. If 46 chromosomes are there, then that is called as a diploid, and if 23 chromosomes are there, then that is called as a haploid. That I shall explain you later. So these types of cells are present. Okay. So cell division is continuously going on. So there is two types of cell division, student. Meiosis type of cell division and mitosis type of cell division. So whenever such kind of cell division is trying to take place into the cell, that time this chromatin fiber is acquiring a shape of a chromosome. Do you understand? Whenever there is a time of a cell division, that time this chromatin fiber, this thread like material, will try to acquire a shape of a chromosome, and it would look like, now I shall rub this and I shall explain you, chromosome. It will, that chromatin material we have seen, that whenever there is a time of a cell division, it will try to acquire a shape of a chromosome. Like this structure it would form. This is one chromosome. Likewise, 46 chromosomes are present in every cell, somatic cell. And into the sex cell, there are only 23 chromosomes are present. Understood, student? So, like this structure would get form, and that is called as what? Chromosome. Here, chromosome. Chromo means what? Color. And zome means what? Body. Color body. One of the scientists was there who tried to observe the cell. He found a color body into the nucleus. And that, for that color body, he said as a chromosome. And why he gave a name chromosome? Because chromo means what? Color. And zome means what? Body. Okay. So this is the structure of the chromosome when there is a time of a cell division. Now what happens, student? This middle one structure is called as a centromere. This middle one structure is called as a centromere. Okay. And these two structures we can see, these are called as a chromatid. As two chromatids are there, these are called as a sister chromatid. These are called as what? Sister chromatid. Okay, student? And the end part of this chromosome is called as what? Telomere. This part is called as a telomere. Okay. Now what happens, student? This is all about the structure of the chromosome. Centromere, then sister chromatid, these two structures are called telomere. But if we will see this chromatin fiber we are knowing. Now again I will draw this structure and I will show you. Now if you will see, it will have that chromatin fiber like material into the chromosome. The whole chromosome is composed of like that. Now I am not going to show you all. Here I will show you. This structure is formed. And if you will see this structure, if you will see this structure further, this structure, if you will see, this structure is this. This is what? I am not drawing any snake, student. This structure is double helical strand of DNA. Double helical strand of DNA. This is what? Double helical. Helix. If you will take any, we can resemble this structure with a twisted rope. If there is a stair of a rope, which is made up of rope, and if you will try to take it into two hands, and if you will try to twist it, it will look, the shape of that structure will resemble to this DNA structure, right? So what is this? This is the DNA, means all your chromosome is composed of this structure. And the full form of DNA is what? Deoxyribonucleic acid. Deoxyribonucleic acid. This deoxyribonucleic acid is made up of phosphate group, phosphate group and ribose sugar is present on the strand, and this you stair like structure you can see, this is called as a nitrogenous substance. This is proteins we can say. DNA is made up of histone protein and ribose sugar, okay, and phosphate molecule. This is made up of that we will see in detail in later higher classes, or I may teach now also. If you will have that reference, I shall go in detail for it. So this is made up, this DNA is made up of what? Ribose sugar, I said you, phosphate group and the nitrogenous substance, means that is protein, okay. And then the segment of the DNA, if this segment of the DNA is called as what? Gene. This structure is called as what? Gene. And this gene is getting transferred from one generation to the next generation by our parents, by the sexual reproduction. And students, so that this is the mixing. How does it taking place? We will see you. This process is called as the DNA copying or DNA replication, that we will learn in higher classes. So what happened exactly here? These genes, the half of the genes are coming from the mother and half of the genes are coming from the father. So students, you are looking like your mother also and like your father also. Some characteristics are like your mother, some characteristics are like your father, and some characteristics which are not like both of them, that is called as a variation, student, okay. So variation is taking place during sexual reproduction, and gene is the segment of DNA which is transferred from one generation to the next generation by the process of sexual reproduction. And so that gene is called as a hereditary unit, because the characteristic or the traits are getting transferred from the parents to the next generation by through genes only. So it's performing a major role in it, okay. So this is all about the your chromosome, okay. One more important structure is remaining, that is called as what? Nucleolus. I send you nucleolus. Nucleolus I had drawn here. It was a fiber like material and this nucleolus was there. Nucleolus is also spherical in shape like nucleus. This nucleolus is also spherical in shape. This is also spherical in shape. This is dense than chromatin fiber. This material is dense. And what exactly it is present? See, as students, to prepare this chromatin fiber, we need one raw material. That raw material is getting provided by this nucleolus. So it contains RNA, ribonucleic acid, and proteins. Ribonucleic acid and proteins are present into the nucleolus. Okay, student. And what exactly this nucleolus is performing a role? What nucleolus does exactly? Nucleolus is preparing ribosomes. I said you, ribosomes are present into the cytoplasm, right? And these ribosomes are synthesizing what? Protein. So these ribosomes are getting prepared by this nucleolus. Nucleolus is also called as a factory of the ribosome. Why it is called as a factory of the ribosome? Because nucleolus is synthesizing ribosomes, is producing ribosomes, right? So nucleolus is called as a factory of the ribosome. And as it is called as a factory of the ribosome, and the ribosomes are preparing the proteins, okay? Proteins are getting synthesized, which we need for a lot of things. That proteins are not only for the bodybuilding, for this DNA material, for all this process, we need a protein. Protein is the major event. Preparing protein into the body is the major event. That proteins are made by the ribosomes. So nucleus has also its own importance, which is also situated into the nucleus. So I hope this all the terms are clear for you. Okay. So in today's session, I have tried to cover cell wall, then cytoplasm and nucleus. About chromosome in detail we will see in the further classes. Okay, student? Thank you very much.